We found out just today before we played it at 5 o'clock, this is the first time in the United States it's been seen in a theater. All the other film festivals have been doing it virtually. We're the only, he was quite taken, the first audience, you know, this is about all we're allowed to have. We could probably have about 50 more people here by the code. But he came out to a group of about 17 for the first show, and I was so apologetic. I felt so bad that we had dragged him all the way here. He was delighted. Just because I haven't seen it with an audience since the Vatican, when he showed it for the Pope. I'm sure he's coming. So any other questions about this? Still looking for the filmmaker. Yeah, thank you. I mean, I know they're delighted to see me. Any questions about this? Yes.
Was it hard to decide whether or not to do an in-person festival versus virtual?
Yes, only in that we didn't know if we could pull it off. It wasn't a hard decision. We knew we wanted to do it. We didn't want to jeopardize anybody's health, the staff or the audience or our filmmakers. But the festival, I mean, it really needs people, you know, to make it work. Anyway, without further ado, Evgeny, come on down.
Now you probably will understand why a Jewish boy can fall in love with the personality of Pope Francis. I've been asked a lot of times, what made me, Jewish boy, to tell the story of this Catholic person? Because he is a person from the capital letter, a person, a human. And I guess that's what made him to fall in love with him. Is his humanity, is him being humble? Is him being simple on the same level like all of you? You know, I've never been intimidated. I guess when I first time met him, it was a little bit kind of a heart beating. I was feeling like my heart is chasing something, like a race pace of my heart. But then I never felt this again. I felt a human being, like a father, like a brother, next to me, who is listening and who is sharing his wisdom, who is sharing his experience. And that's what this person became to me. And I hope after all what you watched, you also learned something. It's expanded your horizon in terms of issues that are surrounding us, human beings, in this world, big world. And at the same time, I do hope that each of you, when leaving this beautiful auditorium, will think what you can do to preserve this world for the future generation. To do something that will allow us to go into the future from this pandemic. And that's what I felt when I was creating this movie and when we were doing a lot of reshooting, re-editing during the pandemic itself. Because for me it was the red line. Red line to rethink everything, to leave something behind, and at the same time to think what I need to take with me into the future. For my own kids, for the kids of my friends, for the future of this world. So that's what is my this movie about.
Questions, go ahead and raise your hands and we'll try to answer them.
Yes.
How did you get Pope Francis to agree to this documentary?
Can you repeat the question?
The question is,
how did I meet Pope Francis to agree for this documentary? In 2018, when I came to Vatican for the first time, almost 3 years, at the beginning of next year. I met Monsignor Dario Vigano, who was the prefect of communications of the Vatican, a big film buff who previously was introduced to me via letters by the director of the Venice Film Festival. I opened Venice Film Festival in 2015 as one of my other movies, and Venice Film Festival director really loved my art. So he did initial introduction in 2017 between us, and when I arrived to Vatican in 2018, Monsignor Dario Vigano, he said, I'm familiar with your work. I'm giving you green light to go and start like everybody else. I'm not promising you any conversations with Pope, any interviews. Now, there is stubbornness and persistence that is in my blood. I did two immigrations in my life. I immigrated to Israel by myself when I was 18 from former Soviet Union, and I left Israel in 99 and permanently moved to the United States, and I'm American citizen for a long time. So I persisted with my goals. But I realized that sometimes you need to find your own ways, which I experienced in all my movies. You need to find your ways to the characters. In 2018, at the beginning of the year, when I got green light from Vatican, I went to Argentina, where I met all his friends, close friends, his family, bless you. And I, through them, I started to establish certain contacts, and obviously with the people in Vatican who surrounded Pope Francis. And slowly, slowly, through the email exchange, through different types of the interactions, I established my contact with him, which I am cherishing, and I established my relationship with him through these 3 years. And through this relationship, I had a lot of meetings with him, I learned a lot from him, and that's how this movie been created. He saw that I'm not trying to create another commercial movie about Pope Francis. This is not a movie about him. This movie about us, human beings. And he is just an amazing person who just helping me to reevaluate issues through this world and point us to the right direction. Not as a leader of the Catholic Church, not as the Catholic person, as just a fascinating role model whom we're missing in these days, as the leader of the world, because we're also missing leadership in this world. And I guess that's what was important for me, to have some kind of a role model that can point us in the right direction in these turbulent times, and that's what he became. And when he understood my mind, he slowly, slowly joined this task. And for him, I will tell the truth, he is not a person of a camera. He rather go to the corners of the world to help to the people. He rather take media with him to bring attention to the refugee crisis, to the crisis on the American border in Mexico, to climate change, to the sexual abuse, to the women empowerment, to Rohingya refugees, to the Armenian genocide, to the situation between Palestinians and Israelis, to the situation in Central African Republic. He rather jump into the plane and go into the places where the military conflict. He is this person of the action. He's not a person of the media. And for him, it took time to understand my brain that I'm not trying to create from him leader or king of the world. I'm trying to use his knowledge to point us human beings to the right direction. And that's what allowed me to create this trust, and he saw a part of the movie, actually. In August when I was with him, he saw a part of the movie, and then in October when I was with him, during my birthday, he saw the part of the movie, and he liked it. He actually thanked me for bringing these issues to the bigger world, because these issues are close to his heart.
Up there, go ahead.
To portray them in particular
You know, I will tell you something about my background, then you will understand. The completely artistic decisions in this movie is mine. I decided to pick up these subject matters. It's not him. They're just close to his heart and mind. I did a movie that my business partner and producer, Dan Tolmer, who is here, brought me to Ukraine, where I witnessed interface dialogue, which is close to his heart. And I, who been born in Russia, raised in Israel, never saw in my life what is interface dialogue. Opportunity of coexistence of every religion next to each other. Seeing how it's possible, I experienced only on my own. Then Syria. Then initiated the whole process, and then I basically executed the movie about Syria. I, who is Jewish, who too went to Syria and Lebanon, Hezbollah territory, I saw the darkness of today's world. It was a journey into the darkest side of humanity. Actually, thanks to Greg, who brought this movie in 2017 and awarded this movie here in Fort Lauderdale, this movie also became a catalyst to the action. All my previous movies became advocacy, activism, and action, kind of call for action. And this movie, like Christ from Syria, was about refugees and migration, which is close to him. So for me, I realized that each and every movie is a call for action to different issues that we created. When I was doing a lot of research on him, I found that climate change, refugees, migrants, all the borders, family separation, what happened here, all the women empowerment thing, the situation which basically unfolded in front of me is the sexual abuse of the church, and many other issues like Armenian genocide, or Rohingya refugees, or Israel, but it's how Pope tried to create find kind of solution between Palestine and Israel, trying to kind of create a link between both sides, and it's not happened in Jerusalem, but he immediately brought both of the leaders, Shimon Peres and Mahmoud Abbas, into the Vatican, where we witnessed amazing interaction between two leaders. It's interesting to observe these things, and that's where my choices to start kind of put things together. There is many situations, and I will tell you, there's many situations that not in the movie that I took out, and I was like cutting my reeds every time I was cutting different segments, which probably will be in a Blu-ray or DVD version. I will tell you something, there is fascinating stories. There is fascinating stories that I can continue all night telling you, which we captured and we have. Stories about kids, stories about prisoners. Pope Francis in 2015 hosted 25 prisoners from Argentinian prison in Santa Marta without knowledge of Vatican. And he inspired them. And I've been in that prison with these people and I learned from them fascinating stories. In 2018, he had a child, 7 years old, Emmanuel, crying on his shoulder. Because Emmanuel's dad, who was atheist, baptized four of his kids. And Emmanuel was one of them. And his dad died from cancer. And the teacher in the school said, your dad will go to hell because he is not a Catholic. And you know what? Emmanuel was crying on the shoulder of Pope. And you know what Pope said? How come this human being can be far from the God when he raised such beautiful kids? And he baptized him. He tried to make you close to the God. Do you think the Father will allow something like this happen that he'll be far from him, from the Father, from the God? And the audience, it was in front of a lot of people, said, no, of course, he will keep him close. And he comforted the child. And then Pope Francis said to Emmanuel's mom, you know what? Sometimes we need to look not in black and white like in a book, but they see the world in full colors, and that's what we're missing. So when we look at the Pope Francis, you need to see much more bigger things, much more open things. Not by the book black and white sometimes, but with the lot of colors. And you know what? When I was picking subjects, I was trying to decide on the most important subject matters of today's world, which are related to us, to human beings. And it was tough to pick up the choices. My first cut, initial cut of the movie was 6 hours. What you witnessed is hour 56 minutes. So Pope never guided me, same as Vatican never guided me. I was on my own artist with all my own freedom. But I was true to myself, and true to my beliefs, and true to the conversations that we had in India with Rita. So that was important to me.
Yes, go ahead. If you stand
yeah,
up, please.
I know you. I'm so proud of you. And I thank you so much. That film was amazing and so poignant in the times that we're in right now. And I hope that so many people can experience it, no matter what race, creed, or color they are. I'm Catholic. You made me more proud than ever in my life to be Catholic. It has nothing to do with that. He's an amazing man. But you, sir, are amazing. You made my whole everything in 2000. Crappy year, you made it right now.
Thank you. Thank you for your goals, and I hope that the rest of the Catholic world, instead of picking only 20, 30 seconds that are all the time rotating in the news, will start to pay attention to majority of the issues that we as a humans created. Because when we're thinking about the future of our own kids, when we're thinking about pro-life meaning, true pro-life meaning, he is the true pro-life person. Because he cares about us, he cares about climate change, which eventually affecting our lives, which eventually affecting our breathing. He cares about people who crossing the oceans, who crossing the basically the seas just to save their kids from the wars, to allow their kids to breathe and not to die under the bombs. He cares about people who are in the middle of conflicts to stop these conflicts. I witnessed how this 83 years old person went on his knees in front of three leaders of South Sudan in April 2019 in Santa Marta and was begging them, it's his own words, he said, please stop bloodshed of innocent people. I'm begging you. Please, if you want to fight, fight behind the closed doors. But in front of the people, be the fathers of the nations and hold the hands. And he went on his knees and kissed the feet of each of these leaders. That was the most strong statement that I ever saw from any leader and the most humble statement. He was begging for the innocent lives. That's what means pro-life. And many other situations that we see in this movie is referring to him as the amazing pro-life person. So that's why I think the Catholic world should be proud of him, because he is the pro-life. He is trying to preserve what is the institution of the church, if we're talking about Catholic church, but he's also trying to preserve what means the big world. Because he cares about the little boy on the street, no matter what is his color of the skin, or his religion, or if he believer or not. He cares about every human being, no matter his race, no matter his beliefs, no matter his sexuality. He is a priest. And this word I got from him many times. I'm a priest, and I care about every human being. And that's who he is. He's an amazing person.
A big round of applause. Thank you so much.